of course, out today. And Dan Lust, sports law attorney, joins us now. And Dan, House versus NCAA has been agreed upon. Now, I know that there are other hurdles for them to go through. The judge has to accept it and on and on and on. But the NCAA and the power conferences feel very strongly that this will help them a lot. Do you think that they are right about that will help them? And what are they maybe being a little too optimistic about?
First of all, pleasure to join you guys. I'll say, I think as you know, Paul, my phone has been ringing off the hook today, yes, which is generally good news. So a lot of questions. So I guess first and foremost, why I think they think it's a good deal. There has been rumors again, you know, lawyers, as this might come as a shock to some, do not have to tell the truth. So during the course of settlement negotiations, if somewhere along the line, the truth is exaggerated, you know, lawyers are not testifying under oath. And I say that because there have been reports that if they took this to trial, that the House team, the plaintiff side, thought they could get a $20 billion judgment against the NCAA. So in that sense, right, is it a good deal? The NCAA and the schools could tell themselves, hey, we basically took a zero off the judgment. We're settling for 2.8 as opposed to 20 or 25 or 30. And, you know, we do have that in the reserves. We have enough to really pay off the lion's share of settlement. And we get to pay it out over 10 years as opposed to if we lost that trial, like the NCAA did during the Alston case, you know, the judgment in theory would be due as soon as the case was done. So you get 10 years to pay it off. You have some wiggle room. So I think that's what they told themselves, that we have a lot of exposure at trial if we lose, and we have to pay it immediately. And now we get to pay much less, and we get to pay it out over 10 years. So, you know, on a very large scale, that's what they're saying is the best part of this. And, you know, you asked me what I think they're being overly optimistic about. You alluded to it. This settlement is not like a walk in the park, right? When you're settling and you have, you know, 15,000 plaintiffs on one side, you have 100 member schools, you have, you know, $2.8 billion, this thing doesn't get approved overnight. And, you know, certainly in our legal space, we're hearing whispers that it might not be a walk in the park to get all of the plaintiffs to opt in. So if you have loose plaintiffs out there that in theory could bring a different or similar cause of action against the NCAA, you know, that there's a lot of things here that could trip up the settlement. So I know everyone's, you know, doing their victory lap, but, you know, as the lawyers, the devil's in the details, and this thing is not yet signed, sealed, or delivered.
They feel that their enforcement, one of the things that jumped out at me, Dan, was they felt that their enforcement would be more ironclad with this. And while it might be, one of the things that they think that they can wrangle in is pay for play from boosters. But there has been nothing in any of the courts that has indicated that any judge in any part of the country agrees with that at all. I think basically based on the, you know, capitalistic principle is it doesn't matter what I want to pay you for. If I want to give you money, I can give you money as long as I'm not asking you to do anything that's against the law.
Yeah, that's where I think, and you guys are spot on. I'm seeing some reporters, and I don't want to call anyone out by name, but they're saying, you know, this settlement guarantees that there'll be no further litigation, you know, against the NCAA. And I'm like, I just don't know how you would do that. Yes, the parties to this lawsuit are the NCAA, the member schools, and these athletes. They are not the federal government. Until we hear that Congress is somehow signing off on the settlement, there is still antitrust exposure. And if boosters want to pay an athlete, I'm not quite sure legally how this settlement would prevent it. The boosters, right, the collectives are not parties to this case. You can't tell them what they can't do as third parties to the litigation. So I'm not quite sure how they do that. And plus, I think it bears mentioning, right, enforcement, right? Who is enforcing this? Is it going to be the NCAA? Because I'm well aware of case law that says the NCAA is not allowed to police put caps on earning potential. So is there some third party that's being started, some new regulatory body? I'm not sure, but, you know, there's a lot of questions I haven't, and hopefully they're answered as more of these details of the settlement become public. But the one that you just pointed out, that's the big question. I'm not quite sure how this cleans up the space while also preventing the NCAA from further liability. I'm just not seeing that.
Yeah, I've heard a couple of people say, they're quoting their NCAA sources, that they really feel that this will allow them to control that a lot more. And I'm like, it just doesn't, you know, there's not been anything that indicates that, you know, this is, and it's not like those things have been said. The courts have not told the NCAA, go do this and then we'll rule in your favor. They've been saying everything you've done is wrong. So no, you can't enforce these rules.
Yeah, I think, you know, as someone that, you know, sometimes I'm involved in big litigations, they get settled. These things get more expensive as you get closer to trial. And I'd say as you start spending that type of money as you prepare for trial, the appetite and willingness to settle tends to decrease. Sometimes you settle on the courthouse steps, sometimes you don't. But I think if you're the NCAA, and again, I'm reading the news like you guys. Sometimes I hear things. For this particular case, I'm hearing what I hear in the media. As this case is getting closer to settlement, I think the NCAA is of the opinion, and what I would be telling them if they were my client, get all the schools on board, just hope and pray that all the plaintiffs opt in this case that seems to be getting a little bit of publicity now. Fontenot versus NCAA, which is a Colorado class action lawsuit against the NCAA. That case is not yet consolidated with this settlement. So in theory, you have another class action lawsuit that's hanging out there against the NCAA. So if you're the NCAA, great. You settled for $2.8 billion. Hurrah. You guys did it. There's no more exposure. You can't get sued again. Meanwhile, we already know of a case that a judge in Colorado is saying does not have to be consolidated with this. So I mean it to say, I think if you're the NCAA, you have to get everybody tentatively on board. And then you have to hope and pray that all this momentum brings all the other parties to the table. You get the consolidation. You get the plaintiffs to opt in. It's not a done deal right now. And I think the NCAA just has to be operating that it will get done. But that's why you're hearing just kind of like blissful optimism. But we're legally, technically, procedurally, we are not there yet.
So what would have to happen for Fontenot to get rolled into that?
Well, if you're listening to the lawyers sniping each other in the media, the question is whether that case should get wrapped into this, whether it's, we'll say, a common nucleus of fact that it's essentially the same lawsuit. I'm not quite sure it's there, and the court in Colorado had a hearing this week where they didn't feel it was there either. Now, that doesn't mean that the court in Colorado is correct, and we'll see what happens at the end of the day if these two cases should have been consolidated. But as of now, there is another case on the books, a class action lawsuit, where the Winston Strawn law firm is not representing these plaintiffs, so it's a separate cause of action. The Carter and Hubbard cases, those were tied to the same law firm as the House case. That's why three cases were able to be consolidated. Yeah, if it's a fourth firm that's not involved and plaintiffs that are not common to the other cases, you know, it's not a walk in the park that the case will get consolidated.
Dan, what do you so if you're the NCAA and the plaintiffs, like what would the you said not getting all the plaintiffs on board. What would you think would be the sticking point? Would be the amount of money that they would be getting, which, you know, spread out over 25,000 athletes, you're still going to get a nice check, but it's not going to be something that's a life-changing money.
Yeah, I mean, you could figure out a whole host of reasons, especially, you know, in this context, right? It's $2.8 billion paid out over 10 years. If you told me, right, if I was a retired athlete, and that's where the $2.8 billion is going to retired athletes, and you know, let's say I have a good job and I'm, you know, working in finance and I'm doing something and I don't really need the money. And someone could tell me, hey, if you took this to trial, you could get 10X and you could get paid it all in one lump sum. I mean, I don't think you need to go further from that to see at least some motivation not to opt in or at least try to create some disruption in the settlement. But by and large, I mean, this is going to be sound money to all these prior athletes, and $2.8 billion is a big number, and certainly going to have the lawyers who going to take their cut of that pie that are going to be encouraging it. So, you know, I think the majority of the plaintiffs are going to opt in. I'm just more worried on a procedural sense if we get all the approvals from the court system to consolidate these cases. Otherwise, you know, maybe all of a sudden the NCAA has less motivation to settle. But, you know, if you're reading the news articles, I think a lot of which is from NCAA reporting, Charlie Baker has his report. They think this is a done deal, but, you know, it's not. The judge has to approve. There's a lot of pieces to this, even just the logistics of what these payments will look like, what the revenue sharing model will look like moving forward, whether they'll be salaried employees, how, you know, if they're going to be on the payroll. I think there's just a lot of loose ends, which, yes, we've passed a major one with the Power 5 or Power 4 and the NCAA signing off, but, you know, that's one of a number of checks that has to happen.
What would the details of what have to happen for a judge to say, oh, I don't like this?
You'd have to think it was unfair in some way, shape, or form. Not really concerned with the court signing off. I think that I'd imagine, unless I'm missing something, the court would sign off. I'm more concerned about the looming exposure to the NCAA from other cases, in which case, you know, the actual temperature for settlement might change. And if you have plaintiffs being very boisterous and saying, don't opt in, you know, we'll see. This is the, you know, you've had the Oregon, I apologize, the Dartmouth basketball team speaking out. You know, it just takes one momentum shift for this to change. But we're really not even at the point for people to opt into the settlement because it is still so raw and the details are still being worked out. So let's see. I'm not like a glass half empty guy, but I remember, you know, I think coming on your show about a year ago with the PGA Live settlement, and everyone's all excited how this thing was going to merge together and the settlement was a walk in the park. And we're a year later and that whole settlement fell apart. So it wouldn't be the first time in recent sports history where a massive settlement that was approved in theory dissipates. So, you know, I'm just not ready to call it a you know, to close the page on this litigation just yet.
Yeah, they don't want to be on the aircraft carrier saying mission accomplished yet.
Right. That's it. I'm not Mr. Negative. I'm just pointing out it's not yet done.
Yeah, don't roll out the banner. All right, one more case I'd like to ask you about before we let you go. And this was one that was kind of inevitable, or something like this would have been inevitable, but Jaden Rashada versus Billy Napier and the NIL Collective and Hugh Hathcock and all that. This was going to happen. A lot of these NIL deals that are promised are probably never done in writing, but this one is very much done in writing. The contract's out there. People can see what they promised him and all of that. This would be the kind of thing that's ripe for a settlement. If I'm Billy Napier, I don't want to have to go in open court and go, did you say you'd give him $1 million? And he'd be like, yes. Did you know that you had that money? No, I didn't. You know, I was told I did. It's just kind of embarrassing all the way around. How do you think that this navigates its way through the legal world?
So I tend to think this case is much more fun. I mean, obviously, House has much more seismic ramifications across sports, but for kind of like salacious litigation where the bodies are buried, I think this one's a lot of fun. So I've been lecturing on this case for about 2 years. I'm very familiar with the ins and outs of this one. I think when it first kind of perked up 2 years ago, it could have been much bigger, right? Because Jaden Rashada could have said, hey, unless you pay me X, I'll go public and Florida's going to get punished and get the death penalty and, you know, you'll be in NCAA purgatory forever. What happened, you know, I don't know, 5 months ago at this point, is Tennessee's attorney general sued the NCAA and basically is now preventing the NCAA from enforcing type of punishments, as I kind of alluded to earlier, for these type of recruiting violations. So, you know, Tennessee's attorney general did it for the University of Tennessee, but because it's a federal court, it might have the same basis of not allowing Florida to be punished. So, sure, Billy Napier might have exposure, you know, the boosters might have exposure. I think, you know, again, if Florida starts winning national championships, different story. But Billy Napier being attached to a direct scheme for a coach working with a booster to facilitate a $1 million payment, upfront payment as part of a $13 million NIL deal, you know, at the time, right, was patently illegal by every stretch of the law, by NCAA law, Florida law. Coach could not be involved in that. It had to be a separation of church and state for Title IX purposes, for 100 different purposes. So, you know, it's not to say that it didn't happen across the country. But this is a $13 million contract by Jaden Rashada, who ends up not playing a down of football for Florida, goes to Arizona State, now doesn't have the lawsuit, and quite coincidentally, maybe, maybe not, the second he transfers to Georgia, yes, in SEC country, is when all of a sudden he has the appetite to file a $14 million suit against Florida. And, oh, by the way, he checked with Kirby Smart before he filed. I think that was probably a smart idea.
Yeah. Well, I mean, you know, you don't want to, you know, get your coach saying, well, no, it's going to be a distraction and all that. But no, go get your money, Jaden Rashada. I mean, look, that usually when you seem to have this kind of thing, what would prevent him from getting from winning this? With it's clearly they didn't have money to give him and they breached a contract.
Well, the problem is it's not a breach of contract lawsuit. If it was a breach of contract lawsuit, it would be pretty straightforward. I was owed X amount of money. I wasn't paid it. Therefore, you know, I'm owed the money. Under this contract, apparently there was language that said this could be terminated at any time for any reason. So it's not a boilerplate breach of contract case. What it's being pitched as is one of two things. That one, it was essentially fraudulent inducement that Billy Napier and the boosters knew that they were never going to pay him $13 million. And it caused him to lose his $9.5 million commitment from the Miami Hurricanes Collective. So in that sense, he's saying I would have been paid $9.5 million, but for you guys telling me I was going to get 13 and me switching my national letter of intent. So that's half of it. And the other half is a similar concept, tortious interference with the contract. We had a valid binding contract. I would have got paid $10 million, but for you guys coming in. So it's kind of artfully drafted. The weakness in the complaint, as you guys kind of are getting at, fraud is a tough concept to prove. You have to prove that Napier and the Florida boosters knew that they were basically giving a bogus $13 million offer. Now, fraud is not the sole portion of this complaint. You can get around it with a torts claim. But I think it's unlikely that Napier and the Florida boosters are just throwing out $13 million for the hell of it. I imagine they thought it was a good faith offer when it was made, and potentially things changed. You know, that doesn't get you out of tortious interference. So, but fraud, I think it's going to be a little bit hard to prove here.
Dan, you're the third or fourth different attorney we've had on the show this week. And of course we wanted you to hit cleanup because you're, you know, a legend with us here, and thank you for going through it. I'm just curious, how many law school credits would Craig and I get for essentially four classes this week?
Four classes this week, 15-minute segments, 15 times four, 60 minutes. Yeah, you get about one credit.
There we go. All right. Well, I'll hang out a shingle here in about 10 years. So
I'll do that. You get hit with unlicensed practice.
Oh, no. I'll go take the bar. I'll do that. What's the thing that Kim Kardashian did where
She took the baby bar.
Fake
law school.
Yeah, there we go. We can maybe get by over that one. If she can, I feel like I can. So,
shout out to Kim K. If we could talk about the NCAA, Austin and Kim K, we've done a good job on this segment. Always a pleasure.
Thanks, Dan. We'll talk to you again soon. Dan Lust, sports law attorney, here with us on 365 Sports. So, and that's the Legal Minute brought to you by Catalina and Smoak, not attorneys.
Got to find that spot.